When we think of animation, we might recall the colors of childhood, the rich red poisoned apple in Snow White, the bright green sneer of the Grinch, the saturated hues of characters in trick films like A Bug's Life. A key device for the expression of mood, personality, and character, color is one of the most emotionally powerful elements in our experience of the motion picture, and its expressivity and vibrancy have long fascinated philosophers, artists, and scientists. Well, Disney believed that color was essential for animated realism. But color also plays a powerful expressive role in our imagination. Today, we live in a world of color whose normality and ubiquity we take for granted. But how did we get here? What role did animation play in the broader cultural turn to color that began in the late 18th century and accelerated in the 19th with the industrial manufacture of synthetic pigments and the development of color photography, printing, and advertising? What are the links between animation with its synthetic color, glass, and light, and other media like Times Square advertising with its large spectacular signs on which animators also worked? What was the material history of animated color production, and how did the ink and paint departments in which women painstakingly traced and colored the transparent cells shape the aesthetics of animated color? What part did animation play in the dissemination of color in popular culture? My current research, Color, Cell Animation, and Visual Culture, seeks to explore these questions. And my discussion of Disney's wonderful world of color today forms part of the conclusion to this research, partly because the show blends traditional classical and digital animated techniques, looking back in time to Disney's historical contributions with its pioneering silly symphonies and feature films in Technicolor, and forward into the digital era with its computer-generated Pixar films. Long before Gone with the Wind and other films with distinctive color palettes, Disney's Technicolor cartoons played a pioneering role in the early adoption of three-strip or Technicolor 4 cinematography for the movie industry. And of course, long before his innovations in the 1930s, animation was part of film's earliest history from the very beginning, and indeed from proto-cinema with toys like the Zoetrope and the Magic Lantern, through to hand-painted images, to stenciling, tinting, as we see here, and toning with Lotte Reinecke's work. In the 30s, Americans and the world were seeing animated cartoons in lively new colors. Although independent Canadian animator Ted Eshbow came out with the first three-strip animated short called The Wizard of Oz in 1932, not to be confused with the later American film, he had to withdraw it under threat of legal action, as Disney had an exclusive contract with Technicolor to release his cartoons in this new three-strip color process. In the same year of 32, Walt Disney released Flowers and Trees, a new color process, adding new rich blues, greens, yellows, and browns. Disney had a three-year contract between 32 and 35 to use Technicolor, which led to some of his many Academy Awards. A spectacular new attraction, Disney's Technicolor cartoons foregrounded bright, saturated colors through narratives that featured frequent subjects such as toys, candy, and jewels. The novelty of Technicolor frequently appeared in laboratory sequences as bubbles or liquids in test tubes, beakers, bottles, or other transparent or translucent glass objects where magical transformation was afoot, blending the world of science and magic, like here in The Worm Turns, where Mickey Mouse is whipping up a magic potion out of colored liquid bubbles, which will give the underdog special powers, helping triumphant flies beat up spiders and cats win against dogs. The Disney Studio has been a consistent innovator in color technologies, from its pioneering Silly Symphony cartoons to its early adoption of color television in the Wonderful World of Disney series in the 60s, through to experiments since the 80s in nighttime illumination. Indeed, from the very opening of the amusement park, In the mid-50s, fireworks were an important part of the show, as well as the electrical parade and the float. And here we've got some more recent incarnations of this, featuring characters, of course, from Toy Story. And more recently, the Paint the Night parade, which features LED illumination. And again, featuring its characters as an important narrative part of the show. Through to projected animation, where color and light transform space and the surfaces of Main Street and the Sleeping Beauty Castle into dynamic, moving, three-dimensional images. Now, traditionally, animation has been defined as the frame-by-frame photography of two-dimensional cells or three-dimensional objects, which, when flipped or projected, create the illusion of movement. More recently, though, scholars have been debating how we understand the term animation and moving beyond this more technical definition to suggest that animation might be an aesthetic form in which relationships between stillness and movement, between petrification and mobilization, are engaged. And this is central to series like the Roadrunner one. Another way of thinking about animation might be as an art form in which the social construction of humans, animals, the mechanical, and the organic are interrogated and even transgressed, such as that terrifying moment in Pinocchio when both Pinocchio and his friend Lampwick turn into donkeys. Or more comically, when Mickey turns goats into musical instruments. Indeed, what constitutes the living and the non-living are often central to animation, as explored in the Brothers Quay and their uncanny, slightly creepy puppet animation. A third way in which we might think, though, about cell animation, which I want to introduce today, is that aesthetic process in which structural relationships between the transparent, translucent, and opaque are staged, and through which emotions and ideas around permanence and the ephemeral, the fixed and the fugitive, the mortal and the fleeting, coalesce. So, to Disney's wonderful World of Color, this is a show that was created as an entertainment spectacle, and that, as Susanna read, combines water, fire, light, and color, taking up the delicate play of the transitory and foregrounding this material and aesthetic relationship of transparency and opacity. From fireworks to hydraulically engineered musical fountains and pyrodramas, the show's innovations hybridize older entertainment forms with digital controlled light and color, blending tourism, the amusement park, and cinematic projection. I want to suggest today that World of Color's ephemeral aquatic media reflexively and literally materialize the affective fuzziness and softness of our nostalgic memories, or as Disney would want us to have, that desire for that which is past. Childhood, the Disney films, promising if only for the duration of the show that these desires can be momentarily recaptured and relived. I also want to suggest that this structural relationship between the transparent and the opaque persists in new media forms, from digital animation to more recent forms like Google Glass, offering themselves to us as magical archiving devices that can also somehow capture and make permanent the flux of everyday life. So let's begin by exploring some formal dimensions of animation that come together in the show. As I've mentioned, the relationship between translucency, transparency, and opacity is key in cell animation because its production is inherently palimpsestic. It depends upon light to shine through layers of transparent nitrate, as they were initially cells, or acetate cells, and the ones that Disney used were manufactured by DuPont, who also made their pigments. So there's an interesting material history that I also explore that I won't be getting into today. So partially opaque with the painted characters, props or backgrounds, all of them then layered together to create the illusion of depth, as we see here with background and character combined with Donald Duck. Cell animation was a particular mode of industrial animation that dominated in the United States and elsewhere for much of the 20th century. The use of cells was part of the tailorization of the industry to minimize time and a labor-intensive production process. Cells were photographed sequentially, frame by frame, under transparent sheets of glass, like we see here, that clamped down and kept dust from the cell. The greater the layer of cells, the less light penetrated through to the deepest layers, and the more blurry was the resultant composite image. And to compensate for this loss of light, dark colors or letdowns were used on the lower cells in the palimpsestic process. Similarly, the choice of different materials, from pastels to watercolors, oils, or pencils, also mediated the degree to which light passed through the cells. In the contemporary era, because we are dealing with digital compositing's capacity for integration of data, we have a different capacity, which is quite different, and so this loss of sharpness is largely avoided. I want to also mention the importance of light and its mediation on our own bodies here, which enter our brain cells where it is converted from light waves into electrical charges. In other words, on the level of perception, our bodies literally mediate light, and like the transmission of light, the perception of light is always materially embodied through relations of penetration, mediation, and transformation. So not only then is the relationship between opacity and transparency, or more accurately, the translucent, crucial at a formal and material level in animation, as well as in its perception, it's frequently present at the level of representation, spotlighting luminosity, color, and delicacy of design. And here I show you an image created by Oscar Fischinger, famous avant-garde artist who also worked on Pinocchio to create sequences relating to the blue fairy and her arrival to transform Pinocchio from a puppet into a boy, ultimately. And what I'm interested in is these moments in Disney in particular, but it permeates much of animation, these twinkling stars, sparkles, fairy dust, and other scintillating or radiating gradients of luminosity, which are traditional signifiers of transformation. And they are created by alternating opaque or transparent cells with translucent overlays of luminous objects like painted stars. So for example, here, the transformation of Pinocchio, a simple alternation of these images creates the scintillation effect, obviously, at a much greater speed. As Scottish animator Norman McLaren once said, what happens between each frame is more important than what happens on each frame. Like Times Square advertising, starburst animation with its on, off, on blinking process is a form of visual stimuli that organizes our attention, affecting our bodies and our brains and creating a sensual experience, which I see as key in animation. In addition to scintillating light, enabled by the alternation of this opacity and transparency, both classical and digital animation have repeatedly returned to the luminous as both form and subject of sensual fascination. So take, for example, the bioluminescent aquatic jellies in Life of Pi. And here these, one might not think of this as animation, but computer-generated imagery is frequently a form of animation that is under-examined or under-considered. Or compare, for example, this luminosity with the following series of scenes. At the top, you see the Tree of Souls on Pandora in Avatar, James Cameron's Avatar, on the top part of the image. But on the bottom are the Dewdrop Fairies in the Dance of the Sugar Plum Fairies in Disney's Fantasia. Now, despite the very real material differences in production processes, Fantasia's effects were, of course, created through airbrushing and light pencil and pastel shading, as opposed to digital effects. You can see commonalities in the treatment of color, luminosity, and detail that continue to link digital and classical animation. I want to show you a scene now where many of these elements come together in the transformation scene of Snow White, where the Wicked Queen has decided to turn herself into a peddler, in which color is foregrounded. So I'll just play this now.
The heart of a pig, the blundering fool. I'll go myself to the dwarf's cottage in a disguise so complete no one will ever suspect. Now, a formula to transform my beauty into ugliness. Change my queenly raiment to a peddler's cloak. Mummy dust to make me old. To shroud my clothes. The black of night. To age my voice, an old hag's cackle. To whiten my hair, a scream of fright. A blast of wind to fan my hate. A thunderbolt to mix it well. Now begin thy magic spell.
Number one, because it's such a fabulous sequence which deeply affected me as a child, but also because it highlights the spectacularity and expressivity of this new colour process. The four-part chromatic formula the Queen selects, if you recall, combines mummy dust, black of night, an old hag's cackle, and a scream of fright. And I write in more detail about this elsewhere, but in a series of close-ups dissolving, we see the hag's cackle become a beaker of red bubbling liquid that evaporates and recondenses. Each red drop a cackle as the queen titrates color and vocal texture together into the inky goblet. Similarly, to whiten my hair, a scream of fright becomes a synesthetic squirt of white, as we see a thick white liquid turned into its complementary from red to green. With the application of two forms of energy, wind and a thunderbolt, to power the spell, we shift not only to the dramatic climax of the scene, but also to an affective intensification of movement, color, sound, and music. We witness the transformation of the queen's body as it becomes transparent in the flash of lightning. We see the bones of her hands, as if being inside the bubbles of color, offer us an X-ray vision. Her body is translucent as cell animation. Second, the scene reminds us also of animation's two etymological roots, from the French anime and the Latin animare, to breathe or blow. Animation can mean to endow with life or spirit, to start a chemical reaction, and I'm interested in particular in the chemical dimensions of Disney, to intensify or simply to make move, all of which were suggested in Mary Shelley's Frankenstein when she used the word animation to describe the transformations of lifeless matter in a similar laboratory scene. By throwing us down color's rabbit hole with the queen, the scene places color bubbles at the center of magical transformation. Third, the queen's transformation scene also invokes the chromophobic philosophical traditions of which David Batchelor has written, in which on the one hand, color is the property of some foreign body, usually the feminine, oriental, primitive, infantile, vulgar, queer, or pathological, or in the second, associated with the superficial, supplementary, inessential, or cosmetic. In these chromophobic traditions, Batchelor tells us, color is either dangerous, trivial, or both. This diabolical corruption by means of color links the scene to a long philosophical tradition in which color was perceived as a lapse from normative classicism. And here I'm talking about, the diseño versus colore binarism, in which form and line were privileged over hue. The queen's cloaking spell of disguise brings together these traditions as she uses colored liquid and bubbles to transform her beautiful surface with artifice, to figuratively turn it inside out, as she later does with a potion bathing a red apple in a cauldron of sickly green. In other words, not only is color epistemologically connected here through discourses of surfaces and layers to animation's palimpsestic structure, the queen's transformation of her body connects these ideas to normative notions of whiteness, femininity, and cosmetic beauty. The relationship of the translucent and the opaque also come together in the frequent visual figure of the iridescent bubble in animation. Like the eye, a bubble is a sphere with a reflective surface like a screen and can be transparent or semi-transparent like a cell. The bubble is a liminal, temporal, and spatial figure. It is a palisil, or thin diaphanous surface of color with an iridescent sheen, suspended between atmospheric air and the air within it. As color was for Goethe, the bubble is a boundary condition of inside and outside. Like the arrival of Glinda the Good Witch as a bubble of pure pink, who becomes the pinky goodness of whiteness in The Wizard of Oz, a bubble can also be a color skin, and here I'm meaning that in several resonances, an example of the type of light condition that Goethe wrote about, where color is produced by passing through a light transmitting or transparent body, such as atmospheric haze, water, or glass. Sam Raimi's Oz, the Great and the Powerful, also emphasizes the mobile and fugitive nature of the digital bubble in a world in which luminosity and color populate the surfaces of the Emerald City. Bubbles foreground animation's magical capacity to violate physical laws of space, weight, and gravity. In the Dance of the Hours sequence, elephants can be lifted up by bubbles and blown about by the wind. Part of the fascination of the bubble is its structural and temporal evanescence. The iridescent surface, say, of a soap bubble, or here, chocolate bubble, is only possible for a brief period before it snaps or is popped, prompting in us wonder at its fragility and suspense in anticipation of that inevitable pop. The bubble carries our breath encased in it, separated from our bodies, yet made continuous through the zone between our eyes and the bubble as we watch it float away, which we might think of as becoming animated by our anticipation, our desire, our suspense. So the luminosity, the color, the delicate transitory nature of the bubble foreground what I've been illustrating in these remarks on animation's aesthetics and formal characteristics. That is, it materializes in an exquisitely delicate form the nostalgic, fuzzy, and fleeting dimensions which form a center stage in the show itself, to which I'll now turn. The show was made for $75 million. It took about 5 years to plan. It was partly done to revive the struggling California adventure theme parks. It's a half-hour show that's shown in the evening. You can go to it at the end of your day at Disneyland. Or at the California parks. And like the fireworks show at the Sleeping Beauty Castle, its objective was consumerist, to keep you in the park as long as possible, to keep spending money, to spend your entire day there. What it is it projects sequences from some of Disney's best-known classical and contemporary animated films and some live-action films on ephemeral materials, bubbles, water spray, fog, and light, produced by nearly 1,200 fountains, alternating with lasers and jets of fire. And I just want to play a little sequence of it for you so you can get a sense of the show. We'll see how we go for the time. Sorry about that. And this is how the show starts off.
Mm-hmm.
My apologies, the camera was covered. And for reasons of time, I'm just going to skip ahead, just to show you a segue to the next sequence. Okay, now I'm fascinated by this show. It has an undeniable kitsch to it in terms of its the structure of the narrative and it's organized through a series of musical Bildungsroman, basically through certain characters like Ariel from Little Mermaid and to the Lion King. It moves from under the water up into the sky. It moves through films like Up and Toy Story. So it moves from sea to space. And it has various dramatic sequences that feature different characters. Here, of course, the aquatic surface is self-reflexive, foregrounding the story itself. And it also culminates in various dramatic sequences. So going back to Fantasia with the Chernobog character. It uses water in interesting ways, isomorphically to express something of the spatial yearning of many of the characters, a desire to escape, to move upwards and outwards. And it uses water, shooting color and vertical water movement to suggest these literal and metaphoric spatial aspirations. Disney has a long tradition of using water as a key design aesthetic. In fact, many of the Imagineers that worked at Water Entertainment Technologies which was founded by former Imagineers, went on to create some of the major fountains of the world, including Bellagio and Dubai. The show's innovative projections onto differently textured two-dimensional and three-dimensional surfaces and spaces is what Stephen Davison, the vice president for parades and spectaculars, described it as painting with water, elaborating, "We wanted to take fountain technology, various planes of water and textures of water, and use it to tell stories in a new way." Now, how can we situate this show historically? Opening with The World is a Carousel of Color, the show is an homage to Disney's original television series, The Wonderful World of Color, which ran from 61 to 69. The Technicolor array of fountain and laser columns that serves as the show's spectacular leitmotif remind us how often Disney has used the rainbow as an iconic attraction in cartoons, especially the Technicolor cartoons of the 1930s. For example, Funny Little Bunnies, the bunnies paint Easter eggs by drawing paint from the colors of the rainbow. As a recurring image, the rainbow offers a central metaphor for the show's nostalgic promise. Proffered, yet never fulfilled. As tricks of light and color, the rainbow can never be reached. The World of Color performs the prowess of the company's technological innovations with a nostalgia for its own corporate history, and one that we have always been invited by Disney to regard as an extension of our own personal history. Of course, the World of Color's technological innovations rest on a much longer history of Renaissance and Baroque fountain design, themselves dependent on Greek, Roman, and Persian engineering, and whose theatricality, display, and monumentality in the work of artists like Tommaso Franchini, or the water tricks of the Villa d'Este's Tivoli Fountain, where visitors were surprised with water squirts, combined water and music for entertainment. So too with the fountains like those built at Versailles, sculpting water as emotional movement and combining it with fireworks and music. In the 19th century, the invention of steam enables a new capacity that fountains are no longer dependent upon gravity for their propulsion, allowing water to become ever more extravagantly decorative. And this capacity has enabled our own era, here the Bellagio in Las Vegas, and the performative fountains that proliferate around the world. The show is also connected to a very specific history of amusement parks, of which Disneyland is only part of the story. We might be most familiar with Disney's influence on the contemporary amusement park in 55, or in the American amusement park in particular. But it was predated by Santa Claus Land in 1946. And of course, Disney himself modeled his own park on Denmark's Tivoli and a number of others throughout the world. The first era, however, of American theme parks saw 2,000 built between 1893 and 1915, and whose most famous exemplars are Coney Island's Dreamland, Luna Park, and Chicago's Riverview. In these parks, the Ferris wheel and the jetting fountain are key visual elements. These parks help define a new concept of urban modernism, the celebration of motion and speed, the beauty of industrial design, and the experiential interaction of spectator and crowd. Their modernity lay not only in their architecture, but also in their sensorial address. A visual stimulation of electrified spectacle and sound, a kinesthesia of rides and dynamic crowds. And like these, the World of Color relies upon a similar bodily address, addressing the technological construction of spectacular vision and motion across different modes of entertainment. The show is modeled on various important precursors, what was known as the pyrodrama, which was an intermedial combination of theater, circus, panorama, and magic tricks, as well as the disaster genre, in which actors recreated famous disasters like the eruption of Vesuvius. Like these shows, And here we are back again at the world of color. Audiences would gather around lagoons, and the lagoons themselves acted as both protective safety and reflective surface. Now, unlike those shows, though, there were no human actors, but instead a reconceptualization of the fountain as a kind of an actor itself. And I'm interested in how the world of color also affects our bodies. Despite that kitschiness, that undeniable sentimentality of Disney's musical theater content, I suggest that the show's choreography of sound, light, and color in its elaborate rhythmic patterns of movement produces a transitory yet hypnotic spectacle, especially in its live incarnation, which is only not really captured by the film that I showed you before. It's important to contextualize it also in its place in your experience at the amusement park. It's designed for you to rest at the end of an exhausting day. So there is a kind of a hypnotic spectacle produced by the physical exhaustion and the day-long experience of stimuli that the amusement park has produced. In 2012, with the introduction of Glow with the Show, or programmable translucent Mickey Mouse ears, which are worn by the spectators, these change colors through infrared signals and a counterpoint or juxtapose the colors of the world of the show, the spectator themselves becomes an additional pulsing modular unit in the light and color spectacle. I want to conclude today's talk by suggesting some important structural links between the wonderful world of color and the emergence of a new generation of media. Blending the projector and the body, the screen with the spectator, Disney's instrumentalization of the body as site of both exhibition and reception is shared with new wearable digital devices that combine transparency and opacity as an essential part of their structural form and tactile pleasure. In the last decade, Apple, Google, Samsung, Microsoft all developed new wearable computer interfaces, from headsets to watches that connected screens on our wrists or our eyes and attached them to smartphones, allowing us to surf the internet, take photos or videos, and post them online, like the Vuzix smart glasses, which worked with Android. These devices animated our worlds. The now famously failed Google Glass was a wearable headset, of course, which also used glasses to put information in front of our eyeballs, using the bones in our skull to conduct sound into our inner ear. The point of view of the Google Glass, and this is from the point of view of a wearer of the device here, issuing a verbal command and showing you what the point of view would be with the translucent overlay. Asking for a translation of something into Mandarin from English. The device was much criticized for a number of aspects, including its capacity to record without permission. But I want to draw attention to one major aspect, its capacity to overlay the field of vision with data that could prove distracting to the viewer. In fact, at the time that Google Glass first was circulating, there were many parodies that issued in Saturday Night Live skits as well, which suggested that there would be so much advertising that would clutter our point of view that we would, whilst wearing it while driving, and of course a woman famously was arrested for wearing Google Glass while driving, would crash the car. And similarly, more recently, I think with the Pokemon Go and some of the same discursive issues have surfaced, concerns about the effects of augmented reality or even completely different devices like Oculus Rift, which may have more longevity here and that detach us from the world. So how we physically interact with our media devices has changed from clicking a mouse to the strokes, wipes, and pinches that animate our movement through our iPads and iPhones, Androids, Surfaces, and other tablets. And with Google Glass, was expanded to include the wink and the nod, new ways of issuing a command. I want to show you this. This was an early design interface for Google Glass, and it really struck me, although this was not the ultimate interface, It really struck me that they used bubbles as a design aesthetic. Each of the menu items were bubbles that literally popped on the screen, made a little bubbling noise as they went upwards after you selected them. And these were in their early concept videos that popped up on the screen. Although this device or this design element later changed, recent Google videos before the demise of the product retained the bubbles' light and playful associations with childhood. Google asked us to be active, explore your world, and live lighter. It is one which Google wanted us to see as a reanimation, indeed spectacularization of the everyday, one that collapsed the temporal and spatial relationships between experiencing and recording, between seeing and wearing. Google Glass's 2014 invitation to never miss a moment and to live lighter suggested that being in the Google Glass bubble is a magical, indeed transformative mediation of our everyday worlds. A 2013 promotional video even shows this child blowing a giant bubble, for wearing glass means that the evanescent need never be lost. Our childhood can always be archived, always kept. Building on older theatrical traditions of spectacular design, World of Color showcases transitory yet atavistic pleasures in their elemental forms: bubbles, air, fire, light, water. Like Google Glass, Disney's World of Color dematerializes exhibition space as well as screen surface, only to rematerialize, reproject, and reanimate it as an immersive, tactile experience, where our field of vision is filled with scintillating light and metamorphosing translucent water, with color baths and reflected light, just as our bodies become modular light elements in the show. Both Google Glass and Disney's World of Color merged our media with our bodies, our data with ourselves, by remediating older attractions such as the pirate drama and disaster genre, the mechanical musical fountain, and the light show with projected classical and digital animation. World of Color shows how the structural relationships between transparency and opacity persist, indeed especially at that historical moment in which computer animation has replaced cell animation, and when celluloid cinema's death knell has repeatedly been announced. By incorporating us into the show, Disney's World of Color suggests that animation can be understood not only as a specific technical and material process, but also as a perceptual and corporeal transformation in which movement, light, and color enlivens, indeed animates individual bodies, even as we become part of the spectacle. Just as the space between the eye and the soap bubble becomes animated with our attention, expectation, and will, so too does the space between the water, fire, and light show and our bodies become transcribed by an emotive field of light. Paradoxically, through its fugitive effects, its misty surfaces, it reminds us again of cell animation's material history, even as these effects are glimpsed in and alongside their digital replacement in computer animation. But most of all, World of Color would have us believe with our very bodies that the iconicity of Disney's characters lives in but will always transcend the transparent, the celluloid, and the ephemeral. Thank you. And yes, I think that there is a long history clearly throughout Europe, not just of amusement parks, but of these kinds of entertainment spectacles in palaces, and Versailles is, of course, an obvious one. So by no means do I mean to suggest that this technology or this particular combination of technologies is entirely new. The digital programming dimensions clearly are. But it hybridizes old art forms, and so I'm interested in this remediation of the older continuing through, because we often think of new media as being this completely novel dimension, but of course it's not, and it often remediates older media forms, and here I think is a very good example of that. I'm not sure that I would. That's the problem with the show, though, is that I mean, yes, I think of Burning Man and other communal events, which may have this ecstatic, transporting physical and emotional experiential dimension. And despite the alienation and the reification of all of these dimensions in the Disney's commodification of this process, I still, I think what's interesting or intriguing about it is how skillfully it still delivers that, even so. There's something about the yes, but, the it's very kitschy, but, that is intriguing to me in this particular show. And that effaces, perhaps, that alienated relationship between the consumer and the spectacle. And so I was suggesting, I think, that it sells quite skillfully this replacement of the corporate history and nostalgia for its own corporate innovations as part of our own personal narrative of history. And interestingly, it's a manufactured one because it combines classical sequences from the films, but many of those are newly created. They're digitally created. They're not directly edited from the original films, but they feature the same characters. The characters and the sequences from the film, the many stories that they tell in combination with the music, I think, produce this particular skillful erasure of reification and replacement with a personal nostalgia. It covers that over somehow, and I think that that's the gesture that intrigues me as to how they're doing that using these hybrid media forms. I mean, on the one hand, that desire for a more abstract avant-garde direction only went so far, as we know, with the narrative of Fantasia and the specific experience of Fischinger, who did not remain at Disney. Also the work of Salvador Dali and his attempts to make a film with Disney were ultimately unsuccessful. So there are these moments where Disney takes these directions towards the avant-garde, but that they are always contained or limited in some way. But the show itself, I think it's also interesting how it deals with this blurriness, because there's a perfection, which is an important dimension of the Disney aesthetic, which is not fully addressed by the fact that we have this magical, apparitional, ephemeral form where the images are appearing always blurry, always fading, always imperfect in a way, because they're on water, because they're on mist and spray. And yet, of course, as I suggested at the end, that iconicity, that desire that Disney is always permanent in our lives. So I see that there's a paradox with the form in which this show plays, which is both substantial and representational, and yet abstract and expressive. And it's moving back and forth between both of those modularities, I guess. That this issue of saturation is a broader issue than just Disney. The shift towards saturation to extremely bright colors as part of the default settings on our television sets. Disney too has erased its own history in re-releasing its own classical archive repeatedly, from video to laserdisc to digital form. And in those shifts, there has been much critique of the literal erasure of some of the pastel color schemes that dominated in the 30s, and a move to greater saturation, loss of nuance and subtlety in lines and details on the characters like Sleeping Beauty, and so on. So there's literally an aesthetic shift, which is a denied one, in the marketing of Disney's own canonical works. And so that contemporary audiences, when they're watching these films, they're not seeing the same film as the analog versions as they were once projected or even shown previously on Laserdisc. So I think that that's an intriguing one too. It's a history that's also matched in the shift to pigments, where in some of my research and interviewing people who produce the color at a company called Cartoon Color Company, which provided the color for major studios like MGM from the 50s onwards, there was a shift to, by the 60s, what was called more juvenile colors, which featured bright, saturated colors, and which is characterized especially by contemporary animation like The Simpsons, very stark, simple color blocks. So there's a wider aesthetic shift here, as well as a material, an archival history, which is being erased. And yeah, that's what I would say to that in response.